Tum anh chơi những cô cho. Ông chủ động chụp đây. Sau đó bông bậc ca. Bọn to cách đâm đá ca. Nị tệ thì xã đâm đá ca. Chỉ cách chấp đâm đâm đá ca xã đâm đá ca. Nơi rửa sân đi. Ông chụp đây. Sau đó bông. Phương sẽ đây bậc ca. Nơi sẽ đây xâm rạch. Chụp đồn pi. Đôi to từ. Thì mùi cứ sẽ đầy dùm rạch tôn mốt, sẽ đầy bị ca hiếp ai trở tùa dọc bàn này ai cả xa khăn nông xong nông rương thơ vơ chì phó tàng. Ông chung đúng đeo là tập bông, thơm mây ni, bàn trở tùa xong nào bị giả hạ phía nhá, xong pra ai cả xa chùm nuôn bay chìa phó tàng nơi chùa phố mốc ông chung đúng chùm rè. Xong nào tiếng nô, đại trở bàn chùm tùa đòi giả hạ mê tử vi ca phía khá đấy, cứ chia sầm náu xong pra pra ai cả xa đôi khăn cọm này. Có chấm lời đã bỏ xạ xây ban slap chấm đồn pi nhẹ để ban cọt ra đôi đồng nàng mà chạm mình đôi ai cả xa Campuchia để chi ông ca cài rõ tha bị bán để chấm lời nu
Excusez-moi, Monsieur le Président, les interprètes ont du mal à suivre. Si vous pouviez parler plus lentement. Merci, Monsieur le
Président. សេចក្តីសម្រេចនេះសារជាថ្មីឡើងវិញសេចក្តីសម្រេចផ្ទាល់មាត់ស្ដីពីភាពអាចទទួលយកបាននៃឯកសារក្នុងសំណុំរឿងធ្វើជាភស្តុតាងអង្គជំនុំជម្រះសាលាដំបងថ្មីថ្មីនេះបានទទួលសំណើពីសហប្រជាជាតិ ជាភស្តុតាងនៅចំពោះមុខអង្គជំនុំជម្រះសំណើទាំងនោះដែលត្រូវបានជំទាស់ដោយសហប្រញ្ញាសហមេធាវីការពារក្តីគឺជាសំណើសុំប្រើប្រាស់ឯកសារដោយខាងក្រោមនេះក៏ចម្លើយរបស់សាក្សីដែលបានស្លាប់ចំនួន 2នាក់ដែលបានកត់ត្រា đòi đồng nàng mà chạm mình đôi ai cả xa Campuchia đại chi ông ca cài rót tháp bị bal đại chấm lời nô trợ ban đặt nơi nông sơn nông rương chia lệ chia ai cả xa lệ đê hà sấp bốn lừa bốn nâng đê hà sấp bốn lừa đọc pì kho chấm lời đã bao chun chọc cháo ដែលកត់ត្រានៅក្នុងខែឧសភាឆ្នាំ1999ដោយតំណាងឧត្តមស្នងការទទួលបន្ទុកសិទ្ធិមនុស្សរបស់អង្គការសហប្រជាជាតិ UNHCR ដែលចម្លើយនោះបានត្រូវដាក់ក្នុងសំណុំរឿងជាឯកសារD9 អង្គជំនុំជម្រះតឡាដបងក៏បានទទួលសំណើបន្ថែមមួយទៀតរបស់សហប្រញ្ញាដើម្បី Sekarang saya merajut ad, cili le asal, ហើយត្រូវបានអានទាំងមូលឬត្រូវបានសង្ខេបមានតែឯកសារឬផ្នែកនៃឯកសារដែលបានយកមកដេញដោលនៅចំពោះមុខអង្គជំនុំជម្រះហើយដែលឯកសារនោះ ជាកម្មវត្ថុនៃការពិភាក្សាដេញដោលតែប៉ុណ្ណោះទើបត្រូវបានចាត់ទុកថាបានដេញដោលជាផ្លូវការនៅចំពោះមុខអង្គជំនួយជំរះ លក្ខខណ្ឌនៃវិធាន 87.2 ដែលថាឯកសារណាមួយជាកម្មវត្ថុនៃការពិភាក្សា គឺត្រូវបានបំពេញទាំងស្រុងនៅពេលដែលមិនមានការជំទាស់មានតែផ្នែកនៃឯកសារដែលបានសង្ខេបនោះប៉ុណ្ណោះដែលត្រូវចាត់ទុកថាបានដេញដោលនៅចំពោះមុខអង្គជំនួយជំរះឧទាហរណ៍ប្រសិនបើជំពូកណាមួយនៃសៀវភៅត្រូវបានសង្ខេបគឺមានតែផ្នែក នេះទេដែលត្រូវបានចាត់ទុកថាបានយកមកដេញដោលប៉ុន្តែប្រសិនបើការពិភាក្សាលើឯកសារនោះហួសពីវិសាលភាពនៃការសង្ខេបបឋមនោះអង្គជំនុំជំរះអាចយកការពិភាក្សាទាំងមូលនោះមកធ្វើជាមូលដ្ឋាននៃសេចក្តីសម្រេចរបស់ខ្លួនបាននៅពេលដែលឯកសារត្រូវបានយកមកដេញដោល ភាគីដែលបានបង្ហាញឯកសារនោះត្រូវបញ្ជាក់ថាតើខ្លួនសុំឲ្យមានការពិចារណាឯកសារទាំងមូលឬក៏មិនពិចារណាប្រសិនបើភាគីសុំបង្ហាញតែផ្នែកណាមួយនៃឯកសារនោះត្រូវចង្អុលបង្ហាញអំពីផ្នែកដែលពាក់ព័ន្ធនោះនៅពេលដែលឯកសារណាមួយ ដាក់នៅចំពោះមុខអង្គជំនុំជំរះភាគីមានសិទ្ធិក្នុងការជំទាស់ទៅនឹងភាពអាចទទួលយកបាននៃឯកសារនោះដោយបញ្ជាក់នៅមូលហេតុសមស្របភាគីក៏មានសិទ្ធិផងដែរនៅការស្នើសុំព័ត៌មានបន្ថែមឬការបញ្ជាក់ណាមួយទាក់ទងនឹងឯកសារដែលភាគីណាមួយមានបំណងដាក់ជូននៅចំពោះមុខតុលាការ ជារួមបញ្ជីឯកសារដែលបានដាក់បញ្ចូលគ្នាក្នុងឯកសារ E55 គឺមិនមានភាពគ្រប់គ្រាន់សម្រាប់គោលបំណងនៃវិធាន 87 ក្នុងការចាត់ទុកជាឯកសារដែលបានដាក់នៅចំពោះមុខអង្គជំនុំជំរះនោះទេឯកសារនីមួយៗត្រូវតែបានសង្ខេបដើម្បីឲ្យភាគី នឹងអង្គជំនុំជំរះមានឱកាសវាតម្លៃលើឯកសារនោះ2ជាគោលការណ៍ឯកសារដែលបានសង្ខេបនោះគួរតែមានជាភាសាខ្មែរពីព្រោះភាសាខ្មែរគឺជាភាសាផ្លូវការរបស់តុលាការនិងជនជាប់ចោត3សូមរំលឹកដល់ភាគីទាំងអស់ថាមាត្រា 15
ស្ដីពីការហាមឃាត់ការធ្វើទរណកម្មបានចែងថារដ្ឋភាគីរដ្ឋត្រូវធានាថាឯកសាររបាយការណ៍ទាំងឡាយដែលបង្កើតឡើងបានមកពីអំពើទរណកម្មមិនត្រូវយកមកសំអាងជាធាតុនៃភស្តុតាងក្នុងនីតិវិធីណាមួយឡើយដែលបានធ្វើឡើងដោយសារការធ្វើទរណកម្ម លើកឡើងតែឯកសាររាយការណ៍នោះត្រូវបានធ្វើឡើងសម្រាប់ជាភស្តុតាងប្រឆាំងនឹងជនជាប់ចោតនៃអំពើទរណកម្មមនេះជាអធិរាជហើយខ្ញុំជូននីតិនេះទៅលោកស្រីចក្រមដើម្បីបន្ថែម
Thank you, Mr. President. One small correction to the decision that has just been given by the President, which I think derives from the document before the before the interpreters. Under one, the reference is to Rule 87 as being fundamental to the conduct of a fair trial. We do not intend to suggest that only Rule 87.3 is relevant. So that should read Rule 87 is fundamental to the conduct of a fair trial. Thank you.
Thank you,
Mr. President. Dr. Etcheson, would you please summarize those parts of your report, overview of the hierarchy of democratic Kampuchea, which have not yet been the subject of questions to you. Are you in a position to do that? I require the briefest of summaries.
Yes, Your Honor, of course. I'd
Luke
be pleased
Edgerton.
To.
Thank you.
I may wish at various junctures of this process to confirm with you whether or not a particular section has been adequately discussed previously to constitute a summary. This document in the case file was formally described as a written record of analysis. To reiterate for the record what we discussed yesterday, the case file document number of this document is D2.15/66. The English ERN is 00146822 through 00146887. The main body of the paper is 37 pages long, and it begins with a section entitled Overview of Hierarchy of Democratic Kampuchea, which is the title which we have been using to refer to the entire report. The first section describes the center, the zones, the sectors, and the districts of Democratic Kampuchea, and this has been previously discussed. The second section of this report is titled Standing Committee. We have also discussed this section at some length and the various parts of this section of the paper, including personnel and organizational matters, the composition of the Standing Committee, the security responsibilities of the Standing Committee, the economic policy responsibilities of the Standing Committee, and the communications patterns and capabilities of the Standing Committee. The next section of this paper is titled Zone. It begins by describing the statutory responsibilities of zone committees as described in the CPK statutes and includes a graphic that shows the zone leadership of Democratic Cambodia. This section of the paper goes on to describe personnel and organizational matters. There were the responsibility of district committees, the security responsibilities of district committees, zone committees, the economic responsibilities of zone committees, which included prominently achieving the 3 tons per hectare target of rice production and the construction of elaborate hydrological works. This section of the paper concludes with an examination of the communication patterns of zone leadership, both to upper echelon at the standing committee and to subordinate echelons at the sector, district, and commune echelons. The next section of this report is entitled Sectors. It begins by briefly describing the statutory responsibilities of sector committees as provided in the CPK 20 statutes. It includes an illustration of sector leadership by showing the leaders of the various sectors of the Eastern Zone. This section of the report continues by discussing personnel and organizational matters that were of concern to sector committees, and we have discussed this in part previously. It continues discussing the economic responsibilities of sector committees, in particular the 3 tons per hectare production target, and the singular focus on the construction of dams, canals, and other waterworks. This section of the paper concludes with a brief discussion of the communication patterns of sector party committees, including their communications with upper echelon at the zone and center, and subordinate echelons at the district and commune or cooperative. The next section of the paper is entitled Districts. It begins with a brief overview of the responsibilities of district committees as provided in the statutes of the Communist Party of Cambodia. It includes an illustration of district leadership by depicting an organizational chart showing districts and their leaders in the Northwest Zone, Sector 5. The next section of this report discusses personnel and organizational matters that it goes on to discuss the security responsibilities of district party committees, and then continues with the economic responsibilities of district party committees. The next section of the report is entitled Communes, Cooperatives, Branches. This section begins by explaining that the branch was the lowest level of the organizational hierarchy in the Communist Party of Cambodia. This section of the report continues by discussing personnel and organizational matters at the branch echelon of the party. that then discusses security responsibilities at the branch echelon and economic responsibilities. This section concludes with a brief discussion of communication patterns at the branch echelon and how the branches communicated with upper echelons at the district, sector, zone, and center. The next section of the paper is entitled Party Center Military Committee. It describes the constitutional arrangements for military organization and democratic Cambodia, and then briefly discusses the provisions in the statutes of the Communist Party of Cambodia for military organizations, and goes on to describe the composition of the military committee of the Central Committee of the Communist Party of Cambodia. The remainder of this section discusses what we know about the activities and policies of the Party Center Military Committee. The next section of the paper discusses the general staff of the Revolutionary Army of
Cambodia.
This section includes an organizational chart which describes what we think we know about the structure of the general staff. This section of the paper concludes with a discussion of the communications capabilities and patterns of the general staff of the Revolutionary Army of Cambodia. The next section of the paper looks at lower level echelons of the Revolutionary Army and is entitled Division Military Commanders and Commanders of Independent Regiments. This section of the paper begins with a section titled Personnel and Organizational Matters and includes an organization chart which describes the independent regiments and divisions of the Revolutionary Army of Cambodia as of early 1977. This section of the report goes on to discuss the internal and external security responsibilities of the Revolutionary Army of Cambodia as well as the economic responsibilities of the Revolutionary Army. This section of the report concludes with a discussion of communication patterns within the Revolutionary Army of Cambodia. The next section of the paper is entitled Ministries. This section of the paper discusses the executive body of Democratic Cambodia, otherwise known as the government and the legislative and judicial institutions, such as they were. It includes a description of the various appointments which were made in various areas of responsibility within the government, and a diagram depicting my understanding of the structure of the government of Democratic Cambodia. This section concludes with a more detailed analysis of what was happening inside various ministries of Democratic Cambodia, and a variety of bureaucratic and organizational difficulties that were encountered in these various ministries. This section concludes with a discussion of communication patterns within and among the ministries, as well as between the ministries and upper echelon of the Party Center. Finally, this report concludes with a brief discussion of the constitution of and functioning of the People's Representative Assembly. The report continues with Annex A, which consists of 355 footnotes that cite 161 different sources that I relied upon in preparing this report. I'm given to understand that the prosecutors wish to enter into evidence before you 148 of those 161 sources. Also annexed to this report were two additional annexes, which included all of the sources that I relied upon in preparing the report.
Do
you find this to be an adequate summary, Your Honor?
Yes, thank you very much,
Dr. Etcheson. That is most helpful.
Mr. President?
Monsieur le Président, vous aviez demandé à la Défense d'indiquer sa position sur des documents que les coprocureurs avaient distribués aux parties hier après-midi. Il est peut-être temps que nous communiquions nos observations et précisément, M. Etcheson vient de nous indiquer qu'il y a une annexe A à son rapport, mais également, a-t-il dit, deux autres pièces complémentaires. Il semblerait, en effet, et je parle au conditionnel, qu'il y ait également une annexe B et une annexe C. Malheureusement, la Défense n'a pas été en possession d'une traduction de l'annexe B ou de l'annexe C. Et c'est après de multiples recherches, et j'ajouterai perte de temps, que nous avons fini par comprendre que les références des documents des deux derniers documents indiqués dans la liste d'hier matin, les références numéro 39 et numéro 30 renvoyaient effectivement à cette annexe C, qui n'a jamais été communiqué en langue française à la Défense. Voilà, nous avons donc l'explication de la raison pour laquelle nous ne retrouvions pas ces documents ni les références. Apparemment, sur Zeilab, ça ne figure même pas de manière classée. Mais donc, Monsieur l'expert confirme qu'il y a bien un annexe C à son rapport, la défense regrette de ne pas avoir été destinataire d'une traduction de l'annexe B et de l'annexe C en français. Cela aurait évité des pertes de temps inutiles. Merci.
Oui, plus précisément concernant ces documents, je relève que s'agissant du document numéro 30, c'est un document en langue originale khmer. Et a priori, il y a uniquement un résumé qui existe en anglais. Il n'existe pas de version française de ce document. Est-ce que c'est exact? Et est-ce que vous entendez appuyer votre rapport uniquement sur le résumé? Et est-ce que vous pouvez nous dire qui a effectué ce résumé?
Yes, Your Honor.
Craig Etcheson.
There are some documents for which I do rely on an analytical summary of the document insofar as a full translation is not yet available. In the case of document number 30, to which you refer, the confession, the S21 confession of Khom Chum, if I am not mistaken, that summary was prepared by Dr. Stephen Hedder, who was an investigator with the Office of Co-Investigating Judges.
Monsieur le juge, excusez-moi. Vous venez de parler des aveux à la pièce numéro 30. Si nous parlons bien en ce moment de l'annexe C de votre rapport, la pièce numéro 30 est un télégramme. Non, ce ne sont pas des aveux. Peut-être faites-vous allusion à la pièce numéro 30 d'un autre document? Mais il serait bon que nous parlions des mêmes.
Peut-être une question à ce moment-là au bureau des co-procureurs. Est-ce que la liste qu'ils ont notifiée à la Chambre et au parti des documents reprend le même ordre que les documents tels qu'ils sont mentionnés à l'annexe C ou pas? Est-ce que c'est la même présentation ou est-ce qu'elle
diffère?
Thank you, Your Honor, for your question. This matter is slightly complicated by the fact that there are two lists entitled Annex C. In the introductory submission, Annex C contained a large number of documents relating to a wide variety of topics. The Annex C that is attached to the end of Dr. Etcheson's report is a totally different list of documents, and rather, unfortunately for us, confusingly with the same name. The Annex C to Dr. Etcheson's report, it contains a list of 60 documents, and those documents are described in the table that we have provided to the court, the table which contains in total 148 documents. Craig Etcheson, I'll give the document number of that table. It's E55.1. The documents, the 60 documents from Craig Etcheson's Annex C, can be located if one looks at the second column of E551. And if your honours will follow me down the page, from document 1, that is listed as case file document IS Annex C. The next column is document 2.1. That is an introductory submission document.
And
moving down to number 2, the same again. Number 3, the same again, an introductory submission document. But documents 4, 5, 6, and 7 bear the description under case file number D2.15 Annex C number 37, and that reference, or the first part of that reference, D2.5 Annex C, refers to Dr. Etcheson's Annex C. It's, I'm afraid, rather convoluted and a little complicated. It has been further complicated by the process in which those documents were put onto the electronic case file in Zion. And I'll do my best to explain this as carefully as I can, because it may go some way for the court's understanding. My understanding is that although the court management system had in hard copy the 60 documents of Dr. Etcheson's Annex C, they were not given individual Etcheson Annex C evidence reference numbers. And unfortunately, the only way in which they can be found in Zyla, in the electronic case file system, is by going to introductory submission Annex C, then under witness interviews, then under the subfolder witness interviews, they are located at documents 18-83. Now, the co-prosecutors don't know why court management service adopted that approach. We are seeking to rectify it, because as I've sought to explain, it is rather confusing for all parties. It's certainly not of the co-prosecutor's making that we've had this rather complicated numerology. I'm sorry, numerics. But the very short answer to Your Honour's question is that document E55.1, the supporting documents to Dr. Etcheson's written record of analysis, do contain his Annex C 60 documents. But in order to locate them, one must look at the second column and find the references D2.15, Annex C, document number 1, number 2, number 3, etc. I hope that assists in a rather complicated process as to why these documents have been a little difficult for all parties to find.
J'ai un souci, je pense qu'il ne peut être partagé, qu'il ne peut qu'être partagé par toutes les parties. Lorsqu'il est fait référence à un document en audience, lorsque ce document est résumé, on peut considérer qu'il est odieux de... Il est important que l'on puisse avoir une idée exacte du document, de quel document on parle. On doit aussi avoir une idée de la nature du document, de son état de traduction, pour pouvoir éventuellement faire quelques observations, demander des explications concernant sa recevabilité. Donc, j'ai compris que c'était assez compliqué. Ce que je souhaiterais, c'est que lorsqu'une partie souhaite produire au débat un document, on puisse avoir des références. Et vous nous avez fourni un tableau qui est tout à fait utile, parce que nous avons un certain nombre d'éléments. Donc, je souhaiterais qu'on puisse avoir la référence par rapport à ce tableau qui contient des éléments aussi précis. Donc, ceci est destiné à faciliter le travail des uns et des autres et à être sûr que nous pouvons avoir un véritable débat contradictoire. Donc, je ne sais pas, moi je dois avouer que je suis un peu perdu par rapport au document dont il a été fait état par la Défense. Est-ce que vous pouvez me dire à quel numéro il correspond dans votre liste? Dans la liste que vous avez
notifiée.
I share Your Honour's confusion. I don't know whether the Defence are referring to document number 30 in table E55.1, which the witness has identified as a confession, or whether document 30 refers to number 30 of another list. I must confess I was rather confused.
Alors, hier, la Chambre a demandé à la Défense ses observations sur les deux derniers documents de la liste que vous, le Bureau des Co-Procureurs, avez distribué à toutes les parties hier. Au bas de cette liste, les deux derniers documents il est mentionné IS annexe C, 2215, annexe C numéro 39, vous l'avez pour le premier, et le deuxième document, D2-15, annexe C numéro 30. Hier, Mme le juge Carroy m'avait demandé quelles étaient nos observations sur ces documents. Et ce que je comprends maintenant, c'est qu'on vous demande de nous préciser à tous où se trouvent ces deux documents dans votre tableau E55.1. Est-ce que ça est clair? Merci.
Alors, je crois que j'en ai trouvé un. S'agissant du document D215, annexe C numéro 30, je passe votre contrôle, monsieur le procureur. Il semblerait que ce soit le numéro 111 de votre liste.
Yes, indeed, Your Honor.
Voilà, donc je ne sais pas quelle est la référence pour le document annexé
C numéro 39.
Yes, Your Honor. I believe I can provide some clarification on this issue. The document that counsel for the defense refers to as number 39 is an S-21 confession of Chan Som, alias Kang Chok, alias Sai. In the list of documents provided by the Office of Co-Prosecutors, there is also a reference to an S-21 confession of Chan Som, alias Kang Chok, alias Sai. But if I think those are the same documents, that is number 31 in the list provided by the Office of Co-Prosecutors.
Oui, Monsieur le Président, mais si c'est le cas, ça ne correspond pas à ce que vient de dire mon excellent collègue qui a indiqué précédemment qu'en principe, les 60 documents de l'annexe C du rapport de Monsieur Etcheson figuraient dans le tableau avec une mention D215, par exemple, le numéro 10. Parce que sous le numéro 31, je ne vois aucune référence au document de Monsieur Etcheson. Et pire que ça, plus préoccupant, si vous allez maintenant sur Zeylab, et si vous regardez les numéros ORN correspondant au numéro 31, vous indiquez-vous dans ce tableau qu'il s'agit d'une confession du 25 octobre 78, mais sur Zeylab, à ces mêmes références, on est indiqué une confession du 10 septembre 78. Donc ce ne serait pas le même document.
Chơi
Your Honor, I cannot be certain what the source of the discrepancy mentioned by counsel for the defense is, but I would like to make a general observation having to do with S21 confessions that could potentially shed light on this issue. In many of the confessions, I have observed that there are multiple dates. There may be a date on the cover sheet of the confession. There may be several dates on the cover sheet of the confession.
ឯកសារនឹងត្រូវដាក់យកទៅតាមការបរិច្ឆេទមួយណាដែលឯកសារនឹងត្រូវដាក់យកទៅតាមការបរិច្ឆេទមួយណាដែលឯកសារនឹងត្រូវដាក់យកទៅតាមការបរិច្ឆេទមួយណាដែលឯកសារនឹងត្រូវដាក់យកទៅតាមការបរិច្ឆេទមួយណាដែលឯកសារនឹងត្រូវដាក់យកទៅតាមការបរិច្ឆេទមួយណាដែលឯកសារនឹងត្រូវដាក់យកទៅតាមការបរិច្ឆេទមួយណាដែលឯកសារនឹងត្រូវដាក់យកទៅតាមការបរិច្ឆេទមួយណាដែលឯកសារនឹងត្រូវដាក់យកទៅតាមការបរិច្ឆេទមួយណាដែលឯកសារនឹងត្រូវដាក់
is not necessarily a different document simply because it has been cited as bearing different dates.
Toujours aux fins de précision, j'aimerais savoir ce qui est considéré comme étant demandé ou être considéré comme produit au débat. Si je me réfère au numéro 2RN du document original, c'est un document qui, me semble-t-il, comporte 153 pages. Et nous avons un résumé qui comporte, me semble-t-il, 12 pages. Nous n'avons pas de version française. Quel est le document qui doit être considéré comme étant produit au débat? Le résumé, la confession en entier, je vois que là, j'aimerais avoir des précisions. Et peut-être que M. Lespierre peut me dire sur quoi vous êtes fondé, sur l'intégralité du document des aveux, ou vous êtes fondé sur un résumé?
Thank you, Your Honor.
Look, Etcheson, some Akon, look at Krom.
In many cases, I worked with one of our language specialists to go through the original Khmer language version of the confession to identify passages that were of particular interest for analytical purposes. In other instances, we found that the analytical summary contained all of the necessary information for me to proceed with my own analysis. So I would suggest that both the summary and the full Khmer language original should be considered.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you, Mr. President. The President has asked me to invite the co-prosecutors to begin their questioning of the expert Dr. Etcheson. The President thanks the parties for these observations and attempts to assist it in understanding the document references and reminds the parties that if any of them have concerns over any document which the prosecutors or any other party wishes to put before the court, then that concern can be raised immediately so that the court can make a ruling. Is there anything you wish to add to that, Mr. President?
Thank you, Mr.
President.
Thank you, Mr. President.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Est-ce que je peux me permettre une suggestion pour essayer d'avancer? Nous sommes dans un procès où l'accusé a reconnu la plupart des faits qui lui sont reprochés. Est-ce qu'on ne pourrait pas inviter le bureau des coprocureurs à se concentrer prioritairement sur les faits qui restent en discussion et à présenter pour ces faits trois ou quatre documents? Dans les juridictions pénales internationales, on exige en général qu'un témoignage ou un document soit corroboré par au moins un autre témoignage ou un autre document. Il me semble que si le bureau des coprocureurs se concentrait à nous apporter trois ou quatre documents pertinents sur les faits qui sont contestés par l'accusé, nous pourrions gagner énormément de temps. Et pour les faits qui ne sont pas contestés, si vous apportiez deux documents pertinents à l'appui de votre preuve, eh bien je pense que tout le monde y gagnerait, et comme je l'ai dit hier après-midi, surtout les victimes qui attendent impatiemment d'être entendues, je crois. Voilà la suggestion que je formule auprès de la Chambre. Merci.
Yes, thank you, Mr. President. May I just inquire of Met Lu if he sees any difference between the testimony of an expert and that of a witness to the direct facts acknowledged by the accused. It seems to me that the difficulty is that the accused is not always in a position to accept certain technical facts enunciated by an expert, and therefore an expert's testimony may seem on occasions repetitive, but on other occasions may illuminate and explain a much broader picture for the benefit of the court. For that reason, although we have not deliberated on this, I can see a difference in the approach to the questioning of an expert when it comes to the agreed facts that you have raised. Do you have any comment on that?
Merci, Madame le juge, de me permettre à ce stade de rappeler qu'avec tout le respect que j'ai pour le travail de M. Craig Etcheson, il n'est pas véritablement un expert. Il appartient au bureau des co-procureurs. Il ne faut quand même pas l'oublier. Il est ici la voix de l'accusation. Ne le perdons pas de vue.
But you haven't answered my question, which is a general one at this point. Do you accept my proposition that there may be a need to examine an expert more extensively than a witness who simply repeats what the accused has already acknowledged in agreed facts?
Oui, madame, je pense que nous allons avoir d'excellents experts qui vont venir dans ce tribunal et, comme vous l'indiquez, ils peuvent donner une vue d'ensemble extrêmement utile, y compris M. Etcheson. Ce sur quoi je suis plus réservé, c'est sur la nécessité de ramener des dizaines, voire des centaines de documents à l'appui du témoignage de l'expert. A priori, je fais confiance à l'expert. Si j'ai un problème, je vais lui demander, monsieur, sur quel document vous appuyez-vous, mais je n'ai pas besoin, dès le début, qu'il me déverse des dizaines de documents. Voilà. Mais je considère qu'effectivement, nous aurons des très bons experts dans ce procès et j'ai hâte que nous puissions les entendre. Merci.
As we all are, Metrobu, however, I don't think it's the role of the chamber to tell the prosecutors or any party what documents they should put before the chamber until we have had the opportunity to assess those. And of course, you will have that opportunity to comment if you are you consider them irrelevant, repetitious, or any of the other criteria that we must abide by. Thank you.
ជើញលោកមន្ត្រីខ្ញុំបាទឈ្មោះកុងវិស័យជាមេធាវីដើមម្ដងរដ្ឋបាលនេះខ្ញុំសូមចូលរួមជាមតិយោបល់បន្តិចនៅក្នុងការដាក់ឯកសារជូនជាភស្តុតាងចំណុចទី1ខ្ញុំសូមបញ្ជាក់ជូនអំពីច្បាប់រដ្ឋធម្មនុញ្ញនៃប្រទេសកម្ពុជាបាន ប្រាសថាប័នបរិញ្ញាគឺថាស្ថាប័នអយ្យការដើម្បីនាំបណ្ដឹងអញ្ញាយកទៅឲ្យធ្វើទៅជូនតុលាការធ្វើការកាត់ក្តីនិងជំនុំជម្រះអញ្ចឹងស្ថាប័នបរិញ្ញាគាត់មានតួនាទីនៅក្នុងការដាក់បន្ទុកដើម្បីបង្ហាញភស្តុតាងឲ្យបានច្បាស់លាស់គឺថាត្រូវបង្ហាញភស្តុតាងឲ្យលើសពីវិមតិសង្ស័យដូច្នេះចំពោះការបង្ហាញភស្តុតាងឲ្យលើសពីវិមតិសង្ស័យនេះ គឺថាមិនដឹងជាកម្រិតណាដើម្បីឲ្យតុលាការជឿថាបាននោះទេគឺថាកម្រិតយ៉ាងហោចណាស់ក៏ទៅ 98 ទៅ 99% ឬក៏ 100% ទេនេះហៅថាលើសពីវិមតិសង្ស័យ đối chứ này mình miên chấm lách nam muối đây đồng rau ở bên nhà rứa co cũng nát rung đan bên nhà thả trâu tè bằng hai ai cả xa bên này ban hay ai cả xa này mình chấm lách bằng hai ban thì đối chứ này khi nhóm co sống co sờ sao chấm pua bên nhà để khất khất khom răng răng giang sờ 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 ram đồng ca lơ cái này mình đang ở nhà đi tè nên chấm lách tìm mùi chấm lách tìm mùi tiết khi nhóm sôm bằng vai tơ សេចក្តីសម្រេចរបស់អង្គជំនុំជម្រះតែបានសម្រេចថាឲ្យរបៀបនៃការបង្ហាញភស្តុតាងដែលយោងទៅតាមវិធានទី
ông em đây cả xâm lại đập pram nứt tì hay là hốt đầu mong bảy đập pram nứt tì anh chơi anh chơi vinh mình thấy tổng rule thà cá chui tổng rule đó mình đặt đầm bay bàn cái này tổng ra xong rồi